Father God, we just thank you, Lord, so much for tonight and this evening. Lord, we thank you for everyone who's gathered in this place, Lord, to join us for discipleship once again, Lord. And we just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would lead us and guide us within this meeting. Speaking through Pastora, she teaches us tonight, God. And we just pray, Lord, that you would continue to open our ears, Father God, to hear what you are saying and speaking to us in this time, God. What you are speaking to the churches, Lord, that it's for us now, today, God. And we also pray that you would continue to open our eyes, Lord, so that we could see you clearly and rightly the way that we are seeing you in Revelation, Lord. And that you would just continue to transform us, Father God, in our hearts to walk worthy and rightly, Father God, as your church, readying us and preparing us for these last days, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. That's the cry of our heart, right? Maranatha. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Wow. That was a beautiful song. All right. Part of our cry is to study the book of Revelation. So let's take a look. Let's take a look at the notes. Why we must understand the seven churches in Revelation 2 to 3. And let's just do a little bit of review. Just to press in the point, which you already know, but you know, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so we say, and we always remember that Revelation is the book that the revelation of Jesus, the disclosure, the unveiling of Jesus, and because it reveals his heart, his power, and of course, leadership. And very, very important for those three things: the heart of Jesus, which is his heartbeat, his emotion, his affection for us, and his desire for his people. Power, you know, as released by the Holy Spirit, as given to us, as we continue to contend in this end time for the power of the Holy Spirit to be manifested in us individually through the anointing of God, and to us corporately, you know, through the same anointing of the Spirit of God. All right. So we see that in Revelation 1:1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which gave him, Jesus, to show his disciples, his servants, and from his servant to us. Next. I'll just go on very quickly. So the theme is Jesus returning to take leadership of the earth in partnership with his people, that's us, and in reaping the harvest of souls, and in replacing all governments. So we know all governments that are especially resisting against the government of Jesus, against the leadership of Jesus, will all be demolished, remove all of those that are in government, those that are in leadership, in nations that are resistant and coming against the people of God, and God, and his plans and his purposes, more specifically coming against Israel. They're going to be destroyed, unfortunately. And so we know that there will be judgment will be released. And one of the trigger for the release of the judgment will be the prayers of the saints, your prayer, my prayer, our intercession. So one thing to really take note of is that in this end time also, intercession and intercessors are going to have an accelerated, you know, empowerment and anointing by the Holy Spirit. And so I always say that also in this season, especially more specifically because we are now in the end time and in our study of the book of Revelation and the end time, God is really going to allow, you know, a massive manifestation of the seven spirits, as told to us in Isaiah 11. But also we saw the seven spirits very, very present even in chapter one. All right. And so we remember that chapter one was really full of the description of who Jesus is. And he's been revealing to us every aspect of his person, of his character, of his leadership, for the purpose, so that, you know, chapter one becomes the preface, the preamble, the strength, the foundation of our understanding his message to the seven churches. Do you guys see that? You know, he intensifies the chapter one so that we may be very, we may see his purpose, he may see his plans, and we might see what he's really saying to the seven churches by chapter two and three. And then you will notice that after chapter three, we go to chapter four, right? I mean, dapat lang, right? Chapter three is chapter four. But the importance of chapter four is that the invitation to come up here. And so a lot of the succeeding chapters will be, you know, like invitations and plans of what Jesus is going to do. And so the importance of chapter one and chapter two and three are going to be very imminent. All right. So, yeah, we see here in verse Revelation 1:7, again, we're reminded of the same statement in Exodus. Behold, he is coming with clouds. In other words, he's going to cut through the heavens. He's going to cut through the atmosphere. He's going to be visible to all the world. I don't know how that's going to be. I definitely, it's not just because of internet or Wi-Fi, but God is really going to have a parade, a procession all over the world, and he will display himself to everybody, for everybody to see him in his grandeur, in his beauty, in his majesty, in his supremacy, right? All right. So next. So Jesus will come only in the context of a prepared bride in unity with the Spirit. And take note here, I said this earlier, anointed in prayer to release God's glory on earth and to release the tribulation to confront the darkness. See, it's our prayers that will be released for the tribulation to commence. And it is going to confront as well as release the Antichrist spirit, but it is against the Antichrist spirit, and tribulation actually will commence because it will be what the Antichrist persona is going to use against us as believers. It will be his warfare against us. But there's a word, I'm escaping the word. All right. So here we see again, we've seen this, we've talked about this, but you know, the emphasis for the marriage of the Lamb has come and the wife has made herself ready. So this is part of what we're doing. This is part of our preparation. We have entered into that identity of being the wife, of being the bride of Jesus Christ, of the Son of God, and therefore, and that's aggregate, that's for corporate, as a corporate body, and we are making ourselves ready. And understanding the signs of the times, understanding the end times, understanding the book of Revelation, seeing, knowing and getting a revelation of Jesus in all of his aspect, in all of his essence, is going to be very, very important for our own encouragement, for our own strengthening, for our own readiness, and for our own protection. And the more, you know, I think you know that the more you see Jesus, the more clarity you get regarding the things that he's showing us, regarding the things that he's speaking to us. And the more, the clearer our seeing becomes, the better our obedience, the quicker our response to what he's saying to us. All right. Okay. So next to this is Revelation 22, verse 17. Here again, the emphasis, the Spirit and the bride say, come. So really, the presence of the Holy Spirit is going to be very strong. He's going to really pour out himself, you know, upon all flesh. I mean, it may not be in the same manner in one place in as in Acts 2, but the evidences of Acts 2 is going to be present in the end times as we study the book of Revelation. and as we go through the journey of the end times. So here, even Revelation 8, 4 to 5, here, this is what I'm saying, that the prayers of the saints, our praying, you will experience that there is such a draw and an invitation and a hunger and thirst to pray individually, but most specifically, there is going to be a strong anointing, a flooding of the anointing of God to pray as a body, as a corporate body, as a group, as a people. The anointing is going to be massive. The experiencing of miracle signs and wonders and the supernatural will become more evident because of the corporate anointing, the unity. This is what the Spirit of God is talking to us about. And not only unity with the Holy Spirit, but unity with one another. Unity with a local church, with another local church, and with another local church, and maybe even global church. All right. So the prayers of the saints ascending before God, then the angel, you know, and it's being captured. It's being there's evidently a bowl in front of the throne room of God, and it's our prayers are being deposited there, and it is being filled, and soon, and hopefully soon, and very soon, as Jesus comes, as the return of Jesus approaches, that also is going to be filled. And then on the seventh trumpet, as the book of Revelation is telling us, I mean, that bowl of prayer is going to be tipped over, and it will be released upon the earth, and then judgment shall really commence. All right. So our prayers are going to be key, are going to be important in the end times. That's why, you know, I think you are experiencing a desire to really pray more than any time in your life as a Christian. And it is going to be encouraged, and there is going to be an anointing for that, like I said. Next. All right. So just the outline, very briefly, you already saw this and you already know this. Revelation 1, Jesus gives the clearest picture of who he is. We have 18 descriptions. Actually, there's more. But in chapter 1, there is about 18 of them. Revelation 2 and 3 gives us the clearest picture of what he wants. What does he want the church? And this is what he's going to say, and this is going to speak of and speak towards the seven churches in his seven letters. Next. 4 and 5, chapter 4 and 5 gives us the clearest picture of his heavenly commission and resources. You know, what God is giving him to come as a commission, and his commission to John, and then all the resources that will be made available to the saints, to us, to angelic forces, and to the event of his return. Revelation 6 to 19 gives us the clearest picture of how he will prepare the nations for his glory. This is going to be very, very interesting as we go to, as we progress in the chapters. And verse 20, chapter 20 to 22, of course, the clearest picture of our eternal inheritance on earth with him, talking about the millennium and, you know, that when he returns and the ushering of us into that another era, another age for us to enter in. And that's going to be totally a different atmosphere, different age. It's going to be a new earth and a new heaven coming together. I know that many of us, when I was a new Christian, I would always think of, you know, I will go to heaven. I will go to heaven when I die, or, you know, we will go to heaven. But actually, heaven is coming down to us. And so we are getting ready for that kind of paradigm. All right, next. So one of the things, just briefly, we'll go to this, the seven letters to the seven churches is really preparation to overcome and to operate in power. You know, and that, you know, let that come home to us. Let that make us brave. Let that make us courageous. rather than fearful, in spite of what might come, which we don't understand and we don't know the extent of that tribulation and the way of the Antichrist. But we have an idea actually right now, because the Antichrist spirits are already present in our midst. But what we would like to understand is that, and be posture ourselves towards, is that we are being prepared to overcome. And so most of the conversation, the conversation Jesus would be having with the seven churches would be how they will overcome, all right? And how they can operate in power. And so, but here is a beautiful revelation even for me. And that revelation, the book of Revelation, really is an it's a big word, eschatological book of Acts. So, you know, we have seen the book of Acts, how that the book of Acts is the Acts of the Holy Spirit, really. It's Acts of the Apostles, but really Acts of the Holy Spirit through the Apostles and the early first century Christianity. And Revelation, now the book of Revelation is referred to also as that book, eschatological book of the book of Acts. We will see, we will experience, and we will be witnesses of the book of Acts in the book of Acts and the book of Exodus, those two books together, all the great miracles, signs and wonders of God in Exodus, as they were getting, you know, the 10 plagues, and then all the acts of God in the wilderness, all the way up to crossing the Jordan, all of the miraculous things that God has done, plus, you know, together with the book of Exodus, the book of Acts, all of those things, all those miracles, all those signs and wonders together, they will be fused together. And, you know, wow, that's what we're going to see in the end times. And more specifically, you will see it in the book of Revelation. So the revealing the acts of the Spirit through the end time apostles and prophets and the praying church under Jesus' authority, you know, the first century. And that will be magnified in our days, in our generation, in the generation that Jesus has returned. So the seven prophetic messages are instructions on how to prepare and how we will be partnering with him in his worldwide actions. This is going to be very dramatic and very action-filled, you know, story you know, Jesus narrates to us, as Jesus reveals to us the whole book of Revelation. So related all to his second coming, Jesus knows best how to prepare his own bride. So as we see, that's why I really believe one key here is for Jesus wanted us to really see him for who he is, the different facets of his character, the different facets of his leadership, the different, you know, his different prophetic presentation, the different things that he has opened up, like being first to be born from the dead. I mean, you know, he was the beginning, he's the ending, etc. All of those wonderful things is so that we may have a wider and a deeper picture of who he is. And I think as we continue to go back and meditate on Jesus's description of himself, the more we understand. That's why in looking at the seven churches, he will also reveal himself accordingly to the churches that he would present himself. Whatever the need of the church that he would be talking to, he would also present himself in that revelation aspect of what that church would need. I mean, we'll show you. I'm sure you already saw what that meant. But before we continue there, I would like to jump into one common thing that Jesus kind of, you know, said to the seven churches. I mean, there were different things that he said to the seven churches, and I would like to present to you what Myra did for us. But here, and those, you know, those are different categories that the that define the different churches and what Jesus said about them and what he complained about them, what he judged them, etc., what he encouraged them. But that there's this one common denominator that he brought emphasis into the seven churches, and he's bringing emphasis to us also today, and that is the narrative that says, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying." And I ask Angelo to take a look. Let's take a look at all of those scriptures. There are 16 times that Jesus said that, 8 in the gospel and 8 times in the book of Revelation. All right. And very, very important for us to understand this. As you will remember, the devotional for our cry of the bride is really the God who speaks. And another caption that I really should have added there is the voice of God. And I have been, helping us to meditate and go into the different scriptures that talks about the voice of God, how powerful the voice of God. And more specifically, if you just go to Psalm 29, I mean, the whole chapter really talks about the power and, the terrifying, explosive, power of the voice of God. And I'm sure we don't. Before this past year, I did not really think about that until the Lord really showed me to pay attention to his voice and to study it. All right. But here again, I mean, going back, Revelation is full of it. This is what Jesus was totally exhorting at the seven churches. He repeatedly this is the word he repeatedly spoke to in Revelation and also in the gospel. All right, let's take a look at it. But I want to see this, Angelo, in the Amplified Version. Okay, here in Matthew 11:15, he said, "He who has ears to hear, let him be listening, and let him consider and perceive and comprehend by hearing." Very important. I really believe, a few years ago, the Lord impressed upon me that in the last days, in the end times, there will be a disease. I don't remember if it said to me, it will be a biological disease, but it is going to be a disease. It's going to be a condition of hearing. Many people will have a certain kind of deafness. I call it cacophony, a kind of hearing that is impaired, a kind of hearing that is, that is not only hard of hearing, but is hard of comprehension, that is going to have a difficulty understanding what is being spoken. Can you relate to that? I mean, is that something that, you can discern right now? Notice that most people among us, I still don't want to do it. I mean, they plug their ears with what they call this, with our buds, hearing buds, right? Or the big one that goes up to the ears like this. And they walk around and, with all that, just stuffing their ears. And so I did not realize how terrible that is until my son bought me the buds so I can walk around while listening to my tapes or my audio, whatever I'm listening for teachings. But I was very uncomfortable. I know I don't have those wires hanging in me, but it's hard for me. And so I just don't go there. And I feel like that there is a relationship to that, to the inability of many to comprehend what is being spoken. And And to those, and the other condition, hearing condition, impaired hearing condition, is also that many of us are impatient in waiting to listen to what the other person is going to say. There's that impatience. There is that, you know, unwillingness to listen, to pay attention. So the communication in most cases is distorted. Communication in most cases are misunderstood. There's no comprehension in many cases. And so now it makes sense that Jesus, the emphasis of Jesus, even to the seven churches in the book of Revelation, is to hear. He who has ears to hear, I think another translation says, he who is able to hear. So it is an ability to hear. So let him be listening. In other words, that is listening, is a posture. It is an active stand. It is an active positioning of oneself to listen for the purpose of doing and obeying what he or she has heard. And then together with that listening and that hearing, you are prompted to consider what you've heard. And to be able to consider, you got to be able to understand. And to be able to understand, you got to be able to hear with clarity, not just the sound of the words, but the meaning of what is being spoken, the depth of what's being spoken, not just the superficial, you know, value of what is being said, but the depth of what being said, the context of what is being spoken. And so as I was, you know, really meditating on this and studying it, you know, I, again, you know, it's wow, you know, the more I, okay, Lord, I mean, and look here in the Amplified, it says, and perceive. Now you've got to discern what is being spoken and comprehend by hearing. I had a study of this in the past. I guess maybe Pastor Grace also may have this. In the past, I studied the word hearing in Greek. Both the word to hear and to obey is the same. I will not go there, but maybe another time I'll go there. I'll give you the definition, the Greek, you know, word for hearing. But to hear and to obey is the same meaning in Greek. And so, you know, it's very telling for us that for us to hear, it really is, the command is to obey. So we hear so that we may obey. And so here in the Amplified is very expanded for us. Let him be listening, very active. It's an active verb, and you know, it's promoting activity and action. And let him consider, perceive, comprehend by hearing. All right. So immediately in the gospel, Jesus spoke about this. I mean, yeah, give me the next one. Again, Matthew 13, he kept saying this, he who has ears to hear, let him be listening and let him consider and perceive and comprehend by hearing. Okay, so what's the next one? Let's go to, all right, here. Again, Matthew 13, then will the righteous, those who are upright and in right standing with God, will shine forth like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. So let him who has ears to hear be listening. I will go back to this, you know, next time, and we will talk about the context of why he's saying this. But sufficient for us tonight to know that he's very empathic in asking and encouraging us and telling us, whether it's in the gospel or whether it's in Revelation, for us to have a posture and a position of hearing, listening, considering, perceiving, and understanding. All right, next. Yeah, Mark 4. He said, he who has ears to hear, let him be hearing, so active, and let him consider and comprehend. So that's 1, 2, 3, right? 4. Next. Luke 8:8. You know, talk about the word, the preaching of the word, or the sharing of the word, or the study of the word. Some fell into good soil and grew up and yielded a crop and 100 times. That's great. As he said these things, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him be listening, and let him consider and understand by hearing." So it's hearing, I believe, is also a prompt to obeying. So it's an action. So, you know, if you're a good soil, if your heart is right, if your seeing is correct, if your attitude is to perceive, to listen, to understand what is being spoken, or what is being taught, then, you know, that ability, your ability to hear with clarity, your ability to process, your ability to discern and consider will be activated. There will be a sharpening there. The anointing of God is going to open the way for you to not only embrace the seed that was sent, that was released to you, given to you, planted into the soil of your heart, but you will also, as it is, being rooted there, as it's being swallowed up by the soil of your heart, you're embraced by your attitude and your desire and your understanding, then it becomes really, really a powerful seed that will so grow with multiple crop return, right? So even in preaching, how many people, you know, that's why here in Los Angeles, I mean, you guys kind of, you know, wonder, oh, why always every Monday, used to be Wednesday, right? Now it's Monday. Every Monday before intercession, everybody, okay, give your takes, yeah? Because, you know, most people, they would listen to preaching on Sunday, and right after 10 minutes, while having lunch, they forgot what was already preached. And so we encourage everybody to go back to the message and re-listen, and then give your takes. What happened to you? What did you get? How did that, you know, affect your life? And so on and so forth. So that was the reason for that. So if it is fit neither for the land nor for the manure heap, I mean, this is talking about, you know, there's this tree that has been there for a year and it has not been bearing fruit. And so, you know, the owner of the land, you know, would like to cut it. But the gardener was just petitioning the owner of the land to, hey, just, you know, I mean, let me just do something about it. Let me throw, put some more manure, and then, you know, is this the same one? Anyways, so then he emphasized, you know, again, ears, have ears to hear. So he's not just talking to us about the physical ear, but really talking to us of a spiritual ear. You remember Solomon, when he was young, when he was installed as king in place of David, I believe it's, was it in 2 Kings or is it in 2 Chronicles? He asked God for one thing. He asked the Lord to give him, in the Amplified, I think it is in the Amplified version, it says, a hearing heart, a heart that can perceive, a heart that can understand, or an understanding heart, you know, different translations. And other translation, I think King James is, you know, wisdom, and so on and so forth, to be able to lead your people. So that was his cry, and God was, wow. God was kind of wowed by that petition, by that prayer, because he said, you know, normally other kings would say, oh, let me slaughter for me all these other kings, or all these other enemies, my enemies, or give me money, or give me all this wealth. But Solomon did not. He just asked for a hearing heart, an understanding heart, so that he may be able to lead the people of God. And because God was very, very pleased with that prayer request, and because of that prayer request, he said, because you did not ask me for the heads of your enemies, you did not ask me for wealth, you did not ask me for all of these things that other people would ask, I will give you all that, plus the wisdom, a hearing heart, and an understanding heart to take leadership over my people. So it was a very important thing for us to hear. And for me, I have to learn how to hear, because I'm, you know, part of me, in my old age, I've discovered that I have somewhat a dyslexic. I'm dyslexic. I mean, so I transpose all kinds of things. I would have a hard time really, correctly spelling things, and I would just lose it in that way, and I would transpose my words and numbers, etc. And I did not understand what that was. Only recently that I really identified that I had that dyslexia, and it's just by the grace of God that I can even speak the way I speak right now, or write the way I write. I really have to press in to hear what other people are saying. Oh, plus the other terrible thing about me is that, I could somehow anticipate what other people are going to say. And so I'm impatient to let them finish what they're saying, their narrative. And so I would kind of cut in there or just speak up and so on and so forth. And I had to I had to have deliverance of that for that. And God said to me, you've got to be patient. I want you to wait. I want you to listen. Even if you know what they're going to say, I want you to not go there. Wait for them, be patient, and learn to just wait what they're saying. Because evidently, going forward, it was not going to be proactive for me. And I've learned that. And recently, this is the kind of praying that I have been learning, is the prayer of listening. Instead of me talking and talking to God about whatever condition, whatever things I'm petitioning or praying for, or asking him for, or interceding for, in most cases, I would really just sit and listen. I will let him talk to me first and most of all, and then interspersed with what I wanted to say. And it has, a very powerful effect on me towards perceiving, towards hearing, towards understanding, and towards comprehension and discerning. So I know the benefit of this, and part of the emphasis tonight is really on hearing. I really believe that many people will have trouble in the end times. Part of heart of hearing is the condition of the heart. Part of heart of hearing is our attitudes, our character, impatience, and a lack of caring for the other person. And so if we have that kind of attitude, then that same attitude can be postured towards how we will listen to what God is saying to us. Does that make sense? All right, so now take me to the Revelation scriptures, because that's where we will really. So the first time he pressed in about hearing is in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, to the church of Ephesus. All right, we will not go there yet, but just press in, we'll just center into this. He's saying this, he who is able to hear, let him listen. See, it's an attitude. He who is able to hear. Are we able to hear? See, that it's an ability that is already in us, and he's encouraging us by the Spirit of God to use that ability to hear, which is also the posture of obedience. Let him listen. See, that's an attitude. Let him listen. to and give heed to what the Spirit says to the assemblies or to the church. Listen to what the Spirit is saying in the church. To him who overcomes, who is victorious, I will grant to eat of the fruit of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. I mean, you begin to see that here, I believe hearing, sharpness of hearing, having a hearing heart is going to be our pathway to become victorious, to overcoming. Why? I believe because we will have a clarity of understanding. We will understand the depth of what God is saying. What is he talking about? Why is he saying that? We'll have that clarity. And because we have that clarity, we also, will posture ourselves in humility to really hear, to really listen, to really press on. And then it sharpens us and it prepares us in that humble posture to become receptive to what God is saying. And here, will grant you to eat of the fruit. There is a fruit to hearing rightly. There's a fruit in understanding correctly, and there is a fruit and a benefit, actually, profit, to be able to understand explicitly what the Spirit of God is saying. It leads us to a place of success, of victory, and wealth in the Spirit of God. All right, so next. Yeah, verse 11. He was able to hear again. Whose church is this? Is this Smyrna? Isn't it right? Smyrna? Yeah. He who is able to hear, let him listen to and heed what the Spirit says to this. Again, he who overcomes is victorious, shall in no way be endured by the second death. Because this is the suffering church, this church that he's talking to today in chapter 2, verse 11. There's a possibility that they will be killed after 10 days and so on and so forth. And so he is encouraging them that, you may die, but you will not be endured by the second death. Next. Verse 17, again, this is Pergamos, right? He who is able to hear, let him listen to and heed what the Spirit says to the assemblies. And look at the exhortation. To him who overcomes, who conquers, I will give to eat of the manna that is hidden, and I will give him a white stone with a new name engraved on the stone. See, again, not only will rightly hearing and having a hearing heart will position us towards victory and overcoming, but it will also position us to receive the reward that is due us. So, to the Pergamos church, even if there are, Jesus was kind of, talking to them about what's wrong with them, etc. Still, to all the churches, you will find out that he will say this, he have the ears to hear, he overcome, and then here's the giftings. Here's the benefit. Next, the rewards. He was able to hear again here, listen to and heed what the Holy Spirit says to the assembly of the church. This is actually Thyatira, right? Yeah. I mean, this is the Jezebelic church. And in spite of that, God always, to the Pergamos church, Thyatira church, they all have, a remnant of those who did not succumb to the sinfulness of that church. So that, you notice that there's always a reward. Next. There's a reward here, right? What's the reward? Yeah, look at here. I mean, wow. He shall rule them with a scepter of iron, as when earthen pots are broken in pieces. I mean, he will, judge. And his power over them shall be like that which I myself have received from my Father. I mean, wow. And this is Thyatira. And I will give him the morning star. He who is able to hear again, let him hear to and heed. Pay attention to what the Spirit of God says to the church. Next. And we're almost done. This is now for the starting slide. This is the dead church. This is the dead church. Can you believe that? But here you say, he who conquer shall be victorious, clad in white garments. I will not erase or blot out his name from the book of life. Wow, what a reprieve. I will acknowledge him as mine. I will confess his name openly before my Father and before his angels. And he was able to hear, let him listen to and heed what the Spirit of God is saying to the churches. Next. This is the Philadelphia church, right? The Philadelphia church, the Smyrna church and the Philadelphia church, God has no complaint about them. And we will go there, in detail. So he overcomes. He was victorious. I will make him a pillar in the sanctuary of God. Wow. He shall never be put out of it or go out of it. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is Jerusalem, which descends from my God out of heaven, and my own new name I will put on them. He who can hear, let him listen to and heed what the Spirit says to the assembly or the church. Beautiful. It's Philadelphia church. No spot, no wrinkle, this guy's. Next is the last church. Is the this is the Laodicean church. I mean, he who overcomes again. He who is victorious. So we're really leading there. I mean, the seven churches will all become victorious. There is a pathway through victory. And Jesus spoke to them individually about that. And he promised them, this is a prophecy for them. I'll grant him to sit beside me on my throne. Laodicean church, can you believe that? The lukewarm church that was spat out of the mouth of God, that made the stomach of Jesus, really hurt. Sat beside my Father on his throne, and he was able to hear, let him listen to heed what the Holy Spirit says to the assemblies or the churches. Coming to us, I mean, this is exactly what Jesus was saying to the churches, the seven churches, but actually he's talking to us today. 2024. He's telling us, don't be deaf. Don't be catatonic. Listen, pay attention. Enter into the attitude and posture of listening. Don't go ahead of me. Don't be late. Be in step with me. Be listening. Be seeing. Wow. This is a lot. But I believe that this is going to be happening to us. I'm praying that we, in this platform, in this discipleship training, will really grow with such sharp ears, a listening heart. I really believe a listening heart is a humble heart. A listening heart is a yielded heart. Amen. Do you guys get it? Yeah, I'm sure you do. Next. So go back to the next part of, verse 13, Revelation 13. If anyone is able to, again, because all over here, chapter 13 is already, this is massive already here, judgment. This is now where, I think this is where the a trumpet is, or is it the seal? But one of those judgment is already being released over here. And so, again, gotta hear, gotta pay attention, gotta be quieted in your heart, gotta understand what God is saying, and gotta be postured to obey exactly what he's saying and telling us to do. So whoever leads into captivity will himself go into captivity. This is now, the judgment. Okay. Go back to the sequence of the notes. So these letters will show us the kind of church that Jesus is building and what his agenda is. Remember, go back to Matthew 16. Who do you say? Who do people say that I am? You know, the general public, the world, the secular people, those who do not believe in me, they have different opinions of me. But what about you, you, my people, you who are born again? Who do you say I am to you? And according to our relationship with him, we will define who he is. And of course, here we see the narrative here tells us that Peter, amongst all of them, was the only one who really saw, who got a revelation of who Jesus is, that you are the Christ. This is his pronouncement. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus promised him that upon this rock, when you, because of this revelation, I will build you. Because you know me, I will strengthen you. You will become a fortress. You will become a stronghold. Upon this rock, I will build you, and not even the gates. I mean, this is going to be very, very strong. This church that sees who Jesus is, that knows who Jesus is, who's having this impersonal relationship with Jesus, is going to be a body, a corporate body, a bride, a group of people that belongs to Jesus, who will always be strong and will weather all kinds of weather and will be able to come against the whole bulwark of hellish release upon this church. I mean even as I'm talking right now, I feel like, okay, what kind of a church is that? I mean, wow, Lord, you know, how much of us needs to get there? How is that going to happen? Of course, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. And so I believe our dependency on the leadership of the Holy Spirit is going to really play a big, big role. And our love for the truth is going to be another foundation there that will play a big role for us. Our understanding of the Word of God, our discerning operation of the gifts of the Spirit and operation of the fruit of the Spirit, all of this put together by the Holy Spirit is going to become foundational for us, a stronghold for us, will become, you know, the very position, the very strength, and the very stand, and the very faith from which we will be able to carry ourselves in the days to come, in the difficulties to come, in the terror of the tribulation that is to come, and in getting ready. Actually, even right now, before the Antichrist person appears, the Antichrist spirit is here to come against those spirit, to come against the religious spirit, all of those opposition that comes against us to tear us away from the holiness of God and lifestyle of walking right with God. So he defines love here in being built. The church that Jesus Christ is building is also going to be defined by his love. And our relevance as his church is going to be on the terms of knowing his love. That's why a revival for us, a revival of the first and the great commandment is going to flood the churches. I mean, beginning with us right now, not very many is doing that, but definitely that is coming because the Spirit of God is going to be poured out. And the love of God that has been shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost, I mean, already that has been done in Romans 5:5. When we're born again, and it will continue to be poured out on us, and we'll continue to walk in that love as we allow ourselves to be intimate with Jesus, to know him, to draw towards him, and always be, you know, choosing to be at his feet and to be in his presence. So this defines the spiritual maturity necessary for the church. That is love, that is revelation, that is understanding what God is saying, that is having a hearing heart, eyes that are open, eyes that can see, spirit of wisdom and revelation, you know, all of this maturity is necessary for the church under Jesus' leadership. It's going to be a necessity for us to come into his presence always. Not most of the time, but all the time. 24/7 really is that necessity. We cannot be one day or one moment, you know, in his presence, walking in the spirit, and another moment walking in the natural or in the secular or in our own strength or in our own mindset. No, we gotta be in the mindset of God. We gotta be walking in the Spirit of God, being led by the Spirit of God. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, this are the sons of God, meaning this is your sonship. This is where you inherit all the inheritances to which we are partakers of in Jesus Christ. And this it will function in us, and it will cause us to mature. It will cause us to govern. It will cause us to, you know, exercise our authority. Really, I mean, there's so much there. So much for us to be activated towards. And but we're getting there. So part of our of the leadership of Jesus will help us to pray and release God's judgment against the Antichrist in the way Moses released the Ten Commandments, the Ten Plagues on Egypt, and as the apostles established the church in the book of Acts. So we are going to be in charge. That's why the training that we are going through, the exercises that God is allowing us to experience and to be exercised in, you know, he's allowing us to build muscles in our faith, muscle in our discerning, muscle in our believing, in our seeing, in our heart perception, in hearing, in paying attention, and in being kind to others and exercising that love. Amen. I mean, it's a lot, but, you know, we will go back to this. I mean, you know, again, you will notice that I will keep repeating myself, but it is important because I don't even remember them afterwards until I am studying again. I mean, you know what? And so, you know, it's you know, there's so much to learn here, so much. That's why we kept saying that, you know, even our journey here in the book, studying the book of Revelation, it's really going to be very transformative for us. It will, you know, change our paradigm, our attitude. And so, you know, we can be slowly just studying it and just going back to it over and over. Like, you know, you've watched two videos of Joel, and, you know, it just, even if you, I don't know how many times you might have watched this video, those two videos that were your assignment, I mean, still, you got to go back again. There's, you know, that's why you have that as your, in for your file. Go back. That's how study is. I mean, it's never ending. I mean, for me, I mean, all of the videos that I'm sending you, I might have listened to that over and over again many, many times, because after you listen, then, you know, you go back and restudy it, etc. Next. So again, these letters, what defines truth, defines focus that is necessary to equip the church to walk in love for Jesus. See, the Revelation chapter 1, I believe the aim, the real goal of God there, that where in Jesus, you know, unveiled himself, really just, you know, and you will find out. You have to go back there. You have to see more unveiling, more depth, more height, more expression, more understanding. It's because that's really, the more we see him, the more we'll have clarity, the more we will have focus, the more we will love him, and the more we will love his truth, the more we will, you know, be confident in his leadership. And therefore, the more we will follow. And that's the kind of equipping that the church, that we are being called to walk into. Walk in love for Jesus. and responding to that love, experiencing His love and responding to His love. So our love is expressed as we obey His commands. I mean, over and over, John 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. I mean, he encourages us to, you know, this is the proof that you love me. Obey me. When you obey me, you say you love me. When you love me, you say, you know, you do obey me. You know, so those are the evidences of our love is in our obedience, listening, heed His warnings. We, you know, we are humble enough. We are yielded enough to heed what He's saying. We take it, you know, seriously what He's saying. Going back, you know, Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, over and over again, those three gospel, you know, chapters of His Olivet Discourse are so powerful. Pay attention to what He's saying. Pay attention. Believe what He's saying. Believe His warnings. Believe His promises. And of course, here, you know, the 22 eternal rewards, which we will go through. And there will be, because in this last days, there will be great challenges and even more, even if there are challenges, there will be greater rewards. So, you know, that's our benefit. That's, you know, where we are encouraged because, you know, we are being equipped, we are being trained, matured to face all of these difficulties without, you know, fear and without fear without fear and hesitation, but because we know that we're equipped for it, and at the same time, because there is greater rewards waiting for us in the end. Amen. All right, next. So how do we apply the seven letters? Five ways. I mean, I'm just going to read it through to you because you already did this, and then we will study this going forward. So the five ways are to apply the seven letters will be, you know, individually we apply it. These letters were written to inspire us to respond to Him individually. Corporately, that's for us as a church, Forerunners for Christ, Los Angeles and Manila and Palawan, you know. Corporately, as a body, as a unified body, as one. Most powerful application is when us as local churches walk in these truths together. So those are your applications. The next one is really, is it globally? Next. Historically, yeah. It becomes, you know, part of the narrative of the end times, part of the narrative of how Jesus is really going to end this era. The age to which we are now, because this is what is going on is everything that is going on right now in this end times is a transitioning period for us to enter into the millennium. So historically, we apply this historically to us individually and corporately. The letters were first written to, yes, seven historical churches in John's generation. You watched the first video of Joel, right, where he showed us the map of Turkey. And then many of you guys, you've been to Turkey, right? And you understand that all of these seven churches were all in Turkey, in the major part of Turkey. I had the opportunity to be in Izmir or Smyrna, and that's where the first martyr what was his name? I keep forgetting his name. The first martyr in the seven churches, in the first generation, not Stephen, but a bishop. He was burned at the stake, and that is in Izmir. And the venue of where the church in Izmir is still there. It's still present. And yeah, it's a reality. Even if historically it's in the history, but it's also still a reality today. When I first set foot on in Turkey, one of the impression that the Spirit of God gave me was that that I'm standing, my feet standing on grounds wherein the men and women of God had walked, and the seven churches stood, and today it doesn't seem, today they've been buried and even sometimes forgotten. But he said, you know, I am going to overturn this earth, and I'm going to show up again. I'm going to show you again the seven churches in a massively, you know, powerful way in the end times. I mean, something to that effect. I mean, that was like 7 years ago. And so I really believe something is a huge revival is going to happen in Turkey. Although the possibility that the Antichrist may come from Turkey is also there, possibility. Mm. But there's going to be a big revival happening going, you know, in Turkey. Turkey, Armenia, all of that area there in the Middle East. So anyways, not even Israel. I mean, Israel will be another thing. But in Turkey, there will be a big thing coming. So some will see this spiritual condition of the seven churches in Asia representing the first century church in their spiritual condition of and our successive period, right? You listened to Joel, and he told you the story of you know, the different churches, all the other opinions of theologians and so on and so forth. But, you know, historically, this is, you know, the other application for us. Next. Universally, all churches in the first century and throughout 2,000 years of church history, just as the letter to the Romans was for the church at Rome and all churches past, present, and future. So it has a universal application. Like today, the letter to the Romans still is applicable to Romans and to the condition of the Romans at that time in our condition, in our present condition and in the future. Eschatologically, of course, an end time atmosphere, end time preparation, end time events as seen in Revelation 6 to 19. So this is when there will be the most believers in history living in the most difficult time in history. Can you imagine? So we're looking at the seven churches from the lenses of the end times to prepare the end time church. And this is going to be the most difficult time for the church history, but this is going to be the most powerful, challenging time for us as believers in Jesus Christ. This is going to be where massively, you know, the Spirit of God is going to be poured out unto us. Next. All right. So studying the seven letters, what are the common elements in the letters? Historical context. There is a history here, and it is real. It is progressing, but the history will, you know, helps us to see forward what is going to happen in the future. And whatever God has done historically for the first century church and going forward up to this time, our time, he's still going to do massively and greatly in the coming days, in the coming season. So it is important to gain information about the situation of each church, their challenges politically, economically, and spiritually. And so we will see here Jesus strategically selected the seven churches, knowing they would give prophetic insight into preparing the end time. So all the churches, the Ephesus, the Ephesian church, the Smyrna church, the Pergamos church, the Thyatira church, Sardis church, the Philadelphian church, and of course the Laodicean church, all of these churches, all of them, we will see all of them in the churches today. We will see all of them happening, still going forward, you know, their impact, their characters, their ways, their sin, their sinfulness, the way God is going to present himself to these seven churches is still going to happen to us progressively. And this is going to be the prophetic insight. So as we see them in their historical context, we will also see them in the other context, which is, I mean, futuristic context. Next. So the seven churches, the goal of us studying seven churches and the aim of Jesus in showing us and speaking to the seven churches and letting us understand what he's saying to them is so that we may be affirmed in our faithfulness. We may see, Jesus is talking to born-again church, born-again believers. And he's still talking to us as born-again believers in 2024 and going forward. And what he's calling us into this, in talking to the seven churches is pressing us to become faithful to him. Faithfulness is what he's crying out for. Faithfulness is his goal for us. Jesus giving affirmation before correction, you know, or to the Ephesian church, Pergamos and Thyatira. And then two churches received no affirmation, Sardis and Laodicea. Sardis is the dead church. Laodicea is the lukewarm church. So there's no affirmation there. He affirmed the faithfulness of the three. I mean, even if there were corrections, but you know, the real affirmation that he gave is to the Sardis, Smyrna church, and of course, the Philadelphian church. Next. Rebuke for compromise. I mean, he's still rebuking us today. And thank God you're rebuking us. Because without your rebuke, we will not get into a righteous path. Without being rebuked, we are bastardly. We're not children. We're not children of God. So being rebuked, being trained, being disciplined is an evidence that we are loved, that we are children, that God's purposes for us is number one in his agenda. So rebuke for compromise. He rebuked the different churches. He rebuked the church of Ephesus. He rebuked the Pergamos church. He rebuked the Thyatira church. And of course, even the Laodicean church. So here you will see all this correction, and he did not spare them. He gave the sternest rebuke for their passivity, immorality and idolatry, covetousness and sorcery. These were enabled by false teachings on grace that did not require repentance. Today, the false teaching on grace is very rampant. A lot of watered down teaching is happening right now in many churches. And that's why, you know, we're a weird church. I mean, I know that I am not one of the favorites, but I don't care. I'm doing my part because I'm going to be accountable to God when I see him face to face. His fiery eyes will look at me and I don't want to melt. I want to be transformed into gold or into silver, into something precious when he looks at me with his fiery eyes, because I have done what I was called to do and I did finish my course and I did what is pleasing to his sight. So next. Oh, by the way, I mean, one of the real thing that we will notice in many churches and in many, you know, congregation and many people, many believers, is passivity. Passivity is going to be very rampant. Que sera, sera. I mean, okay, especially those who are adhering to the doctrine of rapture. Anyways, we will be raptured. We will not go through the tribulation. We will not really even see the Antichrist. And they will be, unfortunately, very, very hard, because they will experience the a big surprise, because they will not be raptured. They will go through tribulation, and those guys who are in that false teaching is going to become real candidate for the mark of the beast, because they will just, you know, they will not endure any hardship. They will not have the bravery, neither the courage to make a stand for their belief. Exhortation to respond What they must do. Jesus tells them what they must do. Jesus gave actions that he required, often with element of warning. I mean, you saw that, right, in chapter 2 and 3. I mean, the warnings that Jesus gave most were against passivity here. I mean, destruction with an increased blessing and fear, persecution and rejection. We will go to this in more detail going forward. The promise for overcomers, which is, like I said, you know, really, Jesus, I mean, he's, I mean, you know, all of these wonderful things that he promises the seven churches is his promise to us. And I would like for all of us to be encouraged, to be brave, to be courageous, because here, and to be active, to break any attitude, any opportunity to for passivity, destruction, and, you know, just going away. I mean, just being satisfied with a little bit, being satisfied with easy, comfortable. No, let's go for the hard things. Let's go for the difficult. Let's go for the sharp. Let's go for the hard stuff, because the hard stuff is what, you know, I mean, when some people, they pay big money to go to the gym and carry it and, you know, use the weights and all of those what gadget on, you know, to just exercise and you know, gain muscle. And everything that we're doing right now, starting from discipleship training like this, not because, you know, it's us teaching it, but because this is exactly where the prescription of God, as you go and see, as we allow ourselves to enter the hard, the difficult, the testy, and you know, no compromise, the truth. It is going to be difficult, but it will shape us. It will strengthen us. It will give us the courage. It will really make you strong and stalwart. I mean, your faith in Christ will affect others, will impact your community, and it will transform lives, because it has transformed yours. And they will see you, and they will see Christ in you, and they will see hope in you. They will see courage in you, and they will be attracted by that. And they too, you know, will say to you, come, teach me this. Come, let me know that, you know, let me come to your class. Promise for overcomers, incentive for diligent faithfulness to Jesus. Diligence. I mean, for the longest time I was studying, was it Deuteronomy 32? Was it, you know, when, you know, be diligent in our obedience. You know, our obedience is not just comfortable obedience or que sera sera obedience or whatever is easy obedience, but, you know, diligence. So we have to be diligent obedience. And so that will reflect diligence also in faithfulness to Jesus. You know, the fruit of the Spirit must grow in us in great evidence that we, the love, the fruit, the love of God as the fruit of the Spirit must be evident. And that love must birth into joy, into, you know, love, joy, peace will give us the wholeness, will give us the faithfulness, will give us the kindness, will give us self-control, and so on and so forth. Let the fruit of love be visible and made manifest. So promise for overcomers, all right? And so most of these promises are, we will experience accordingly in the millennium, you know, as we go into the next age or next era. But it is also going to be, you know, I believe it's going to really grow in us, and it's going to steady us, and it's going to strengthen us. You know, this promises, this faithfulness, understanding what Jesus is saying to the seven churches. We have insights into the rewards to equip us to stand in pressure. And of course, we will go in detail and study the 22 eternal rewards in the book of Revelation as well. Okay, next. I think we're almost done, right? So the revelation of Jesus, its message begins by calling attention to the specific aspect of his majesty seen in Revelation 1 that was most needed in its church's situation. 16 different aspects of Jesus' majesty are highlighted in Revelation 2 to 3. You will see that in the appendix that you have been sent, you've been given. the 30 descriptions of Jesus, Revelation 1 to 3. All right, next. You have all that. You have the big list of his description and a short list, right? Yeah, take me to, let's go to the chart that Myra made. Because there we can see a enumeration of the different churches. All right, here, Myra has been gracious enough to chart the seven churches in the book of Revelation, wherein, you know, we have the church, we have the title, the description of Jesus, commendation, criticism, instruction, and promise. So it's, you know, look at this church and you begin to see the enumeration of the seven churches. Like for Ephesus, the title of this church is Loveless Church, because it no longer loves, you know, Jesus in the same way as in the beginning, although they're commended with a lot of things. A description of Jesus: he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. We said that, you know, the description of Jesus to the respective church, like to Ephesus, is actually what they needed. He's showing himself in this way because this is what they needed. They needed to see him. They needed to understand that they're part of the seven stars, that, you know, Ephesus is in the right hand of Jesus, and he walks in the midst of the Ephesian church as a golden lampstand. So this is the description that Jesus presents himself to Ephesus, even as they are a loveless church, is what they needed. And the commendation is, okay, your works are good, you have labored, persevered, patient, rejected evil, tested those who say they are apostles and are not. So this is the commendation, and here's their criticism: love for Christ no longer fervent, no longer burning, they're no longer in love with him. They have fallen from the heights of their place and loving him. Instruction: do the first works. What is the first work? Are referring to in loving him with all the heart, mind, and soul. What's the promise? The tree of life. This is so powerful. And, you know, in spite of the fact that Ephesian church is loveless. Can you imagine that? Smyrna is the persecuted church, right? And the description of Jesus: Jesus came to them and presented to him as the first and the last, who was dead and came to life. And we know why this is, right? Because as a persecuted church, they are the opportunity for them to be martyred is very, very evident, very, very available. So he's saying that, you know, I'm the first and the last, you know, I'm the beginning and the end. So don't worry about that. If you die, you will come back to life. That's what they needed to see. And that's where they needed to understand. And they needed the revelation there because of their opportunity to be dead, be martyred. So his commendation: gracefully bears suffering. I mean, they're really, you know, full of grace in carrying on with the persecution and suffering. No criticism. There was nothing wrong with them. They're really just almost perfect. Instruction: be faithful unto death. In other words, they have grace to be faithful even as they are martyred. And the promise: crown of life. Pergamos church is a compromising church. But here, Jesus' description: Jesus revealed himself to him, to them, as the two sharp two-edged sword. In other words, he will cut, you know. And then commendation is that hold fast to their faith. Criticism: tolerates immorality, idolatry, and heresies. What is the instruction? Repent. What is the promise? Hidden manna and white stone with a new name. Thyatira, a corrupt church, idolatrous church also actually. Jesus appeared to them as the Son of God, who has eyes like flame of fire and his feet like brass. What? Judgment, right? Judgment. And then commendation: love, service, faith, patience are greater than at first. All right? So there's a group of them that are there faithful. But what is the criticism? Your works, your love, your service, your faith, and patience are greater than at first. No, actually, they tolerate tolerate that woman, the Jezebel woman, you know, the false prophet who encourages immorality. That's the criticism. Instruction, judgment coming, and keep the faith. So there will be judgment coming to them that have followed the teachings of Jezebel, and to them that has kept their faith, to keep on believing in faith. So it was the promise to rule over nations and the morning star. Can you believe this? You know, those who will endure, those in Thyatira, some of them, the remnant is still going to be, actually, this woman, the Thyatira church, she was the woman who was leading there, the spirit of Jezebel. She was exhorted to repent, but she did not repent. Next church is Sardis, a dead church. How did Jesus appear to them? He who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, because they're dead. They need to come alive. And so the commendation is what? Some have kept the faith. Criticism is dead church. Instruction, repent, strengthen what remains. And what's the promise? Clothed in white garment, name will not be blot out from the book of life. Wow, what a promise. Philadelphia church is a faithful church. How did Jesus appear to them? He who is holy, he who is true. He who has the key of David, who opens and no one can shut, and who shuts the door and no one can open. What is the commendation? You persevere in faith, keep the word of Christ, honors his name. Criticism, none. Keep the faith is the instruction. What is the promise? A place in God's presence, new name in New Jerusalem. The last church, Laodicean church. What is its title? Lukewarm church. Jesus' description, Jesus appeared to them as the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. You know, we will deal with this. We will discuss all of this description of Jesus as we go into the different churches. What is the commendation? None. What is the criticism? Lukewarm, wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. What is the instruction, the counsel? Buy gold refined in fire and white garment, anointed eyes with eye salve, and zealous remnant. Promise, share Christ's throne. Can you believe that? A lot of this are scary. A lot of this is awesome. A lot of this is really mysterious to me. But we will study it and we will take a look at what God is saying. And then, of course, at the end of this, you will see in the chart, you know, the repeatedly Jesus saying he has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And so this is kind of the theme as well of our study in the book of Revelation. I mean, have eyes to hear, have ears to hear. And we remember the continuous prayer of Paul to the churches, actually to the church in Ephesus and Colossians, but to all of us, even today, today's church and the future church, is for us to have eyes to see, that the spirit of wisdom and revelation be upon us. And like we said again, I said again, in these last days, there will be an outpouring of the spirit individually and corporately, and there will be a manifestation, a massive manifestation of the seven spirits of God, because the church of Jesus Christ will need the help and empowerment of the Holy Spirit in the last days to stand in the last days, to stand in the prior to the return of Jesus, to face the persecution, to face tribulation, to understand the things that God will do, to understand the judgment, and to carry on with massive praying and intense praying and activity in prayer, because the prayers of the saints will be tipped over unto the earth to release the full judgment of God. And also our attitude, our lifestyle is going to accelerate the return of Jesus Christ. He's only coming back for a glorious church. He's only coming back for a church ready to become partner with him in the last days. That's why baby churches needs to grow today. I mean, mature churches must grow maturer, you know, must enter into the identity of the bride and enter into that, we enter into that identity of bride. We posture ourselves in all the emotions of God, in all the descriptions of who Jesus is. We become the bride because we have seen the bridegroom. We have, you know, known the bridegroom. We have intimacy and strong relationship with the bridegroom, who is Christ. Whom we behold, we become. And so even as we continue to study the book of Revelation and the end times, we begin to really, we change. I've changed quite a bit just by studying this book and restudying it again. And even as to teach it, you know. And I'm sure you're experiencing the same, and you're finding out that I'm not in a hurry to finish just for the sake of finishing. I would like for us not only to absorb it, but to really digest it, that to really be transformed through it, to be able to mirror what we're studying, to be able to really be a definition of a disciple of Jesus Christ in the end times, who will be able to withstand the persecution that we might face. We may not all face it, but we might face all of the rigors that, you know, we will study here, we will see. We will be able to withstand that. And actually, because of the confidence that we will grow into, and because of the attitude to which we will be formed and transformed, I really believe that, you know, the most difficult testing and situation that we will have to face, we will not even, you know, worry about it. We will be so over it. We will so, you know, be so equipped that, you know, it will not bother us at all. That's why the devil will wake up and tremble and have a heart attack every time we're up. That's the kind of people we will become. That's the kind of church he is building. But that is premised upon this rock. I will build my church. You see me, you will be built. I mean, that's my little one-liner. You see Jesus, you're going to be strong. You see Jesus, you're going to have, you know, courage. You see Jesus, you're going to have the reflection of who he is in your beauty and in your face. Amen. All right. So, okay, it's 9:46. I mean, I'm over time, right? I mean, I spoke as fast as I could, but all right. Any one or two people say something, complain or comment or whatever? Jordan, you're smiling over there. Are you enjoying yourself or you're getting tired? Can't hear you.
Oh, you know, I'm enjoying myself. I love this type. I love these meetings. So cool.
Good job. Thank you, Jordan. Anybody else? Pastor Grace? Commentary?
Well, one of those things that made me make an inventory. You did not take that up because maybe it's lack of time, is the understanding the call to overcome.
Yes, yes. We will go to the next.
Yeah. So,
but that's okay. Go tell.
Okay. So of course we know that the overarching message of the Lord over these seven churches is faithfulness. Mm-hmm. And each of these churches had challenges. God called each of them a challenge to their faithfulness. So it means, I think you wrote here, an overcomer in this context is the one who matures in the specific area of faithfulness that Jesus emphasized in his life or her life.
Yes.
So
yes.
Because before I received the tabulation of Pastor Myra, I had my own tabulation. So let me just I use the word instead of criticism, critic. So, but I'll refer to her tabulation here. So the tabulation that she made about the criticism of that Jesus made, mm-hmm. is really the challenge to the area of faithfulness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But when I was really looking at it without going so specific, is that, Lord, I have been, you know, I did not go past certain challenges to areas of faithfulness,
mm-hmm.
that you were instructing me.
Yep.
Because, you know, sometimes it's just like, oh, maybe it's not that important, or it's just a little thing. But there are really many little things.
Mm-hmm.
Many little things, like maybe sometimes, you know, that extension of having a devotion with you because he is trying to instruct you certain things.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the little things. There are many things, but of course we're short of time. But this is the thing right now that is most important for me, mm-hmm. the challenge to faithfulness. Because if I'm not faithful in the areas that he has called me to overcome, I can't be victorious.
Yes. Yes.
That's why the hearing is vital and the seeing is vital. Those two things.
Very, very key. Yeah.
That's yeah.
I spend more time on the hearing because mm-hmm. that's the sickness. That's mm-hmm. the disease. Yeah.
Because you have already seen.
Yeah. This is
you have already seen.
Yeah. Yeah. Right now, even in their day and in our today and going forward, that's going to be a very, very, a critical problem even today. The reason why sometimes people don't understand, don't perceive, don't appreciate is because they're not hearing rightly.
Yeah, yeah.
And so yeah. It's you know, what we're studying is the cure.
Mm-mm.
Cure. Yeah, I know I did not go there because time wise, but we before your part next week, we will go to that. I wanna go over to who are the overcomers, the three views, who are the overcomers, two different contexts, and then three views. And then I'd like for us to take a look at the Jesus promised 20 eternal, actually 22, Yanni, 22 eternal rewards, and then understanding to call to overcome. Yeah, we will do that, you know, in the beginnings next Wednesday. That's why I'm saying to you, I mean, there's so much. I mean, even if I already sent that to you, I'm sure, I mean, my presentation and my kind of deliberation is still going to be different from that study, because you extrapolate from that study. I mean, then, you know, I get my, you know, even if I've studied that and those are the notes, when I'm teaching it, it still comes differently. Like, you know, I mean, I didn't start in the beginning because I felt the need, the leading of the Holy Spirit is talk to them about ears, hearing, mm-hmm. hearing, because Jesus made emphasis on that.
Mm-hmm.
So another inventory is, how are you hearing?
Mm-hmm.
Because how you're hearing equals how you will obey.
Mm-hmm.
Always. Because like I said, you know, I think I hope I'll have an opportunity to teach on the Greek word, because it's very, very impressive, you know. To hear is to obey. That is the same word.
Mm.
It's the same word. And so if you're hearing, you're obeying. Mm. So it cannot be contradictory, right? But you will find out that, you know, from the hearing to the obeying, there's so much obstruction there. Mm. There is such a fight right there. Because then, you know, the obeying, the actualization of the obeying is going to be contingent on how is your hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And so even just in the hearing, I mean, bokya na tayo, you know, zero, zero, zero. Right? So really, wow, you know. I'm one of I really invest on hearing. Because I know everything that comes out of me, everything that I do is contingent on how I heard.
That's right.
And as I, you know, as I grow older, I tell you the truth sometimes. What did you say? What did you say? You know, my organic hearing is a little bit, you know, slow, but my spiritual hearing is so much more active. Mm-hmm. And that is an exercise that you have to learn. It has a lot of, you know, it's training, it's yieldedness, it's really, you know, humbling yourself before the Lord. And sometimes I feel like, okay, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not getting anywhere, like, you know, like that. But I really am going somewhere. And really, even if we're slow in really learning what we need to learn, in the end, it is going to be, because we're really studying the book that will be the book of all the books. That's the book of Revelation. I mean, we can be so theologically learned and yet not understand what Jesus is saying in Revelation, and we will lose it. So I don't know if we're going to be here for 1 year or maybe more, but we will finish it. And before, hopefully before Jesus returns. So, but before he returns, as we study the book of Revelation and the end times, we will be ready. Do you see that? You know, we will be ready. We will be progressively ready. I promise you that. I mean, you know, nobody who's a student in this discipleship training will come out of this training a loser. You will be so much of a winner, transformed. I mean, you are going to be very contagious to your neighborhood, contagious into your church, contagious into your family, because they will be affected by your changed life and your changed paradigm. That's the goal here. That's the prayer. And I believe, you know, God is answering our prayer. Amen. All right. Okay. Are you done, Sister Pastor Grace? You done?
You're done. Well, hearing, I just wanted to add this one particular line. Hearing is intentional. You know, hearing is intentional. That's why before this discipleship class began, I prayed it out in this way, where, Lord, let my spiritual ears hear intentionally what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. So he will arrest me. Because we can be so 100% present in every discipleship class, but if the hearing is dull, and I know the dullness of our ears is caused by being presumptuous. Mm-hmm. We presume we know the scriptures, we already know this, we have heard this, you know, from other ministers. So we presume, and then we missed out the freshness of what the Spirit of the Lord is speaking today. I mean, that's how the Holy Spirit revealed. Because again, my faithfulness, you know, especially as us as pastors, we can be presumptuous.
Yeah.
So I said, Lord, let me hear.
And that's a worse sin. Presumption is a worse sin.
Yeah.
Because it's actually an evidence of pride that is born out of fear. Very complicated, right? But really, no. Fear really is pride. And pride, you know, in most cases is presumptive, goes ahead of God. That's what I mean by ahead of God, or late.
Late,
you know, delayed. Delayed obedience is disobedience. So very, very, you know, very, very key, very important. I really believe, as we get cured in our hearing, our discerning is going to be sharp. Our acuity is going to be so much, you know. Our kindness, I mean, the fruit of the Spirit, I believe, is going to grow very pronouncedly in us, because you will be patient. You will be humble. We will be humble. We will be full of grace. From hearing, I'm telling you. From hearing, because it will really activate our ability to obey. Okay, amen. Thank you very much, everybody. I know how busy you can be And, you know, I'm praying that, you know, you're enjoying your homework. And if you're not, you can just, you know, take time and, you know, don't let it be a weight for you. Just take it easy and let God help you. All right. But I will tell you, I mean, whatever investment you invest in this study is going to be, I mean, so much wealth that you will enjoy forever and ever and ever, not just today, but in eternity. It's just hard. There's hardship. But, you know, that hardship is nothing compared to the tribulation that we're to face. I mean, look at the Smyrna church. Okay, Jesus did not say, okay, I will deliver you, you know. You're not going to die, you know. But Jesus says, okay, guys, be ready. Maybe in 10 days, you will be martyred. And this is, you know, don't worry. Because if you die, you will live forever. You, like me, you will come, you will be resurrected. You will have, I am the first born from the dead. So you will be the next one. You will, whatever happened to me will happen to you. I mean, he did not, you know, comfort them by being delivered. So we will experience those kind of things. God will not rescue us when we have to suffer. He will probably just give us the grace to endure that suffering. And so, I mean, hello. All right.
Amen.
Okay, Ted.
Amen. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful evening, Father, for the wonderful discussion and listening your word, Father. Thank you for allowing us, O Lord, to see and hear, Father, the spiritual condition of the first century churches, O Lord. We declare, Father, in the name of Jesus, as we heard and as we see the condition of the churches, Father, we declare, Father, continue, O Lord, to guard our hearts. Help us, O Lord, to really hear your voice clearly, O Lord. Open our spiritual ears for us to be able to obey you, O Lord God. And as we obey, Father, we declare, Father, that you will guide us, Father, to really meet those souls, Father God,
yes,
whom you prepared, O Lord, to be with you, Father, in your kingdom. And Heavenly Father, we declare also, Father, continue to increase our prayerful life, Father, in order for us, Father, to pray and intercede, Father, for all the believers and also, Father, for the end time church, Father. We pray, Father, that you'll continue, Father, to purify our hearts, that we will continue, O Lord, to align our hearts to your heart, Father, for us to be able, O Lord, to really come and see the glorious life, Father, that you have prepared for us eternally, O Lord. And Heavenly Father, we pray that you continue, Father, to bless each and every one of us, O Lord, as we continue to partner with you. Continue, O Lord, to listen to your voice, Father. Direct our path, O Lord God. Direct, Father God, for us to be able to always be with you, Father God, in fulfilling the task that you have given to each and every one of us, O Lord. Heavenly Father, we also lift up to you, Father, those people who are sick right now. Father, we scoop in Sister Lilita, O Lord.
Sister Lilita.
And those people who are sick right now,
Johnny.
Father, platform, Father, we declare, Brother Johnny, we declare in the name of Jesus, cover them, O Lord, by the blood of Jesus. We speak life. We speak healing over them, O Lord, in Jesus' name. And once again, Father, we know, O Lord, that you heard our prayers already, O Lord, and you know each and every one's heart, Father. So we just entrust everything unto you, O Lord, and thank you for this book of revelation, Father God, imparting your message, Father, for each and every one of us, O Lord. So thank you so much once again, and we bring back all the praises and glory to you, O Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, everybody. God bless.